Coming up, we got a real great lineup. We're talking about violence.
Actually, we got to talk to one of the survivors of a gunshot victim.
You know, not everybody always gets killed, and
we got the state of emergency out in Oakland for you.
So we got to check that out.
Up next on Yo TV.
Yeah! Welcome to another exciting episode of Yo TV. Yours truly, Josue Rojas, is here.
I am. And we are a part of Yo Youth Outlook. What do we try to do with that?
We do multimedia, the whole gamut, being moving pictures, be it still pictures, be it interviews, be it rock videos. We do it all.
It's whatever you are doing, young people out there in the Bay Area and all over the United States and world. Anyways, up next for you, we have a touching story about getting shot. It's a little bit scary. It happens to young people. And we got Luis, I believe, up next for us, right?
So part of the gist of the story is everybody who gets shot, like, not everybody who gets shot ends up dying. So there's,
which is good.
Yes, which is very good, but which means that there's different kinds of trauma, there's things to deal with,
there's stress,
there's bullets lodged inside of people's body parts, so
my goodness.
it might be a little edumacational, so check it out.
When you see that you still have a bullet in you, you get shot and you're still alive, you're still talking, breathing, all you have are like a bunch of battle scars and, you know, and like things that shouldn't ever work again, they're kind of working, you just, you know, start thanking God, you know.
In the last couple of years, we've had a steady increase in number of trauma victims from gunshot wounds. So a couple of years ago, we had 110 people who were shot. In 1 year, this is not the people who died, these are just people who got shot. That number last year was 175. You know, one day, I was on Sunday 2 weeks ago, and I'm walking around in the ED and somebody walks up and there's two 17-year-olds who got shot. You know, the other day, the kid we operated on, he was 17. This morning I saw a 15-year-old kid right in the clinic. You know, there's a 14-year-old kid I took care of, he was shot. He was in the hospital for a couple months. I mean, there's more and more, I'm seeing much more of that than I had seen before.
Lucky few, because not too many people get hit like I do and come back to life.
Like, it came through here. You see how it gets bigger right there? That's where it came in. This is surgery.
These guys ran up to the car and grabbed bats and started breaking our windows.
It came out down here, I think. It's a surgery again.
So we hit a U-turn, and right when we came out of the U-turn, a car was already next to us, and the guy was already pulling out guns, and he was already shooting at us.
And it came up, it hit me right here. I think it's the bottom one. No, wait, the top one that it hit.
And all of a sudden, I see my hand just fall to my knee. And, like, after it fell to my knee, I just couldn't breathe anymore.
And then right here, they have to go through surgery, open me up. And got two scars right there.
I could taste the blood in my throat.
I got scars right here from surgery.
I couldn't feel my left arm. Like, I was just hurting all bad. Like, my side was hurting, but nothing hurt more than just, like, you know, not being able to breathe, you know, like, because then once you can't breathe, you can't feel anything else, you know.
So to have life, you got to have two things. You got to have air going in and out, and you got to have the blood go round and round. Right, so the blood don't go around and around because it's going out a hole, right, then you go into shock, right? If air is not going in and out, that means that you're not getting oxygen to the tissues, right? So these are all sort of complex, you know, it's much more complex than that, but that's sort of the way that the big picture looking at things what happens. So when a bullet goes in, that's what it does.
I thought I was just scared, that's why I couldn't breathe, but, you know, like, but the bullet had, like, broken through my arm, you know, like, came out, hit me in the side, like, barely, like, ripped a hole in my lung, hit my stomach, my liver, like, hit a bunch of all different stuff, and it's lodged into my back. You know, like, you have your spinal cord and your disc, and it's stuck right in the disc, I think 5 centimeters away from, like, my nerve. So if that bullet would have gone up, I would be paralyzed right now.
The reality is that we do not routinely go digging bullets out of people. And the reason why is because the more we dig is the more we can hurt. You know, so if the bullet goes through the chest, through the lung, and it lodges right near the spinal cord, right? In order for me to go in there and get the bullet out, I have to crack open their chest, I have to cut the muscles in their chest, I have to dig through their lungs, and I have to go into the back near the spinal cord to take the bullet out. Now, during all that stuff, it's a big operation, right? And I have to pull the bullet out near where the bone is at, right? And what happens is you hurt people more by doing that. We essentially deal with the things that will kill the person first, and we try to abbreviate everything up front. And we're not running around and we're not going to fix every little thing. We just fix the big things that's life-threatening, then we pack them, then we bring them back to the operating room numerous times until we got things under control.
The doctor just told me, he's like, all right, it broke your arm, and it just like ripped through everything, and it's still in you, we can't take it out.
What did you think about when he told you that?
I was tripped out. I was like, for real? I was like, I don't believe you. And then I looked at my stomach and I was like, all right, maybe I do.
Then there's the mental problems, and a lot of them will have post-traumatic stress. So what does that mean? That means that they will relive over and over again what happened.
I ain't walking on that block. I tell you, I mean, I'd be tripping out when I'd be taking a bus by there. I won't trip out as hard, but I'll just be kind of, you know, be in the back of my head, you know, like, oh, this is what happened. But, you know, I'll try to, like, listen to music or something, you know, like, just to keep my mind off of it. But, you know, when I'll pass by it on different streets, you know, like, I'll pass by it and I'll see it and I'll be like, it'll kind of anger me, but I'll kind of, like, you know, kind of just like, whatever, you know.
You know, there's obviously innocent people get killed, and most people are young, decent folks who are not looking for trouble. But there are folks who are, you know, in gang life, and the gang life, there's a code. You break the code, you get punished.
The way I think now is know what you're going to use it for and know how that's going to impact somebody else before you end up using it. Or don't just go trigger happy on everybody you see. I mean, just figure out what it's going to think about it at first, and that'll probably really just stop you from using it. Like, think about how that's going to ruin you, ruin, probably kill that person, ruin their family's lives, ruin all their friends' lives, and then, like, just think about what could he have been.
Peanut butter on your bread, that could be something real nasty.
Yeah.
I think we'll just get Little John to do something like that, and it would be a great song.
How about
you
in the meantime?
You can put peanut butter on your bread with it. Peanut butter on your bread with it.
Kind of like peanut butter jelly time. Uh-oh. Anyways, we will be right back.
Wait, you're not going to use that, are you?
Did you know that 1 in 4 adult Americans get their news from ethnic media? Now, New America Media honors the best of ethnic journalism at the first National Ethnic Media Awards. Join us in Washington, D.C. on November 14th to celebrate the country's largest multicultural, multi-ethnic media awards. For more information on the New America Media Awards, call toll-free 1-866-NAM-2006 or visit newamericamedia.org/awards.
Before me were 30 pills, 6 group of 5 each. One group at a time, I swallowed the muscle relaxers down, not wanting to see the next morning.
Pay was normally under the table and always short, but just because it had been that way for a long time did not make it right.
F. Bush is not an uncommon phrase out of the soft mouths of 18, 17, 16, 15, and even 14 and 13-year-olds. But why they feel this way is an entirely more complicated matter.
I received a call 3 months before my release and was told I will be serving my country in the Middle East for a period of 18 months.
Sprawl Magazine is a quarterly publication dedicated to giving much-needed representation to the many diverse groups throughout Northern California and beyond. In giving a voice to our often misunderstood community, we break the molds, tear down the stereotypes, and empower a fast-growing population. Look beyond the picket fence.
Want to stay up to date on what goes on with ethnic and youth media? Visit the New America Media Bookstore. You will find writing and art from homeless youth, literary journals from the Mian community, DVD on mental health advocacy, and much more. You can even subscribe to any of our youth publications or New America Media's directory of over 2,000 ethnic print, online, and broadcast media. For more information, visit www.newamericamedia.org and click Bookstore.
Hello, my name is Elliot McGregor, and I'm a youth intern at Conscious Youth Media Crew in Youth Outlook. I just made a movie, which I was inspired by all the killings and violence that goes on in Oakland. It's called The Real State of Emergency. KTVU, Channel 2 News, was just inspired to come interview me about the movie because there was 96 murders that just last week. And it's what, August, May? I mean, September? But yeah, check the movie out.
Talking about the ghetto. Funky, funky ghetto. Trying to survive. Trying to stay alive.
It's a true war in the streets. People are getting hurt and killed just trying to get on top and out of poverty. Most suspects and victims of violence tend to be young, male and African American. In March, the mayor of Oakland declared a state of emergency. Oakland's murder rate has gone up so much it's up to 50 this year, and it's only April. That's more than 10 killings a month. If this continues, then Oakland will reach a record-breaking murder rate.
Where I stay at in East Oakland, I see a lot of drug dealers hanging outside my house, selling weed, selling coke, or whatever they're selling. A lot of knocks coming over there. Police be over there all the time. A lot of fights every other day.
People just trying to give money.
The mayor and police chief redeployed 115 officers on the streets, doubled the current police force so they can have more officers to respond to calls.
Well, me personally, I think that's good because, I mean, it's still gonna be things going on. It's still gonna be people getting killed and things like that, but it's good that they're gonna have a lot more officers out.
More police will just, they'll be out there patrolling, but some people have like hostility against the police. We need to do something about it ourselves before we can. The police can't solve our problems. We have to solve our own problems.
It's an emergency because, man, the quicker people ain't gonna get no job, man, the more they just gonna be on packing up more on the streets. The more people get disrespected, the more racism go on. It's a wrap. It's gonna be over because everybody just feel me. They feel that the white man don't care anyway.
They see their parents doing it, so they think it's okay, even though it's not, and it gets money, so they live off the fast money.
You see your parents doing it. Naturally, you're gonna grow up, and that's what you see. Constant, you do the whole family, from generation to generation.
These little ones, they see it, and they already starting to do it. They want respect, feel me? That street fame you was talking about, they want street fame. So dudes go just, you know, they go do what they gotta do to get known, get that respect, but then make sure next thing you know about, say about a, they ain't gonna last too long, about a week or two later, they might be end up getting popped.
Basketball, baseball, whatever you put your mind to, man, do something, because otherwise, streets ain't gonna save you.
You want to go to the NBA?
Yeah.
I'm so proud of him, because he's doing things, positive things. Since I've been knowing him as a youngster, this small and up, he always been the type of young man, that respect his elders. You could tell his parents have upraised him right. They got him right where he need to be. Right about now, we need to have him as a model.
They're looking at the economy going downhill, and everybody talking about how big and how great the economy is doing, and they're putting it on the news that we got more jobs than ever before. Where? Show me. All Oakland showed is way out for a young man is drug, selling drugs, being a baller.
The state of emergency to me is the reality of living in poverty in Oakland. Living in poverty creates a state of mind to do what you have to do to get what you need. When you live in poverty, you need money, but many poor people don't have resources like job training and good education, so they can't get things the right way. Just being poor gets in the way of everything.
Yeah, it's not that many opportunities, so that forces them to rob, because they want to live that fast life.
A lot of people that's from low-income families, like they have problems in their family or something like that. Like, some people mom don't want them, or it's people that's in group homes that just going crazy getting guns. They don't have no money, so they trying to get money the best way they know how.
Like if they ain't got it, they probably knock somebody out to get it, just to get it.
Youngsters say that's the fast way to get rich.
In this kind of scenario, a lot of these kids are pretty much raising themselves and learning on the streets while trying to make a name for themselves.
People try to get street fame because they want to get that credibility, you know, they want to be known.
They're raising themselves because their mothers is out there in the life, or their fathers. They don't see any other positive things. All they see is the welfare system.
They need money to do everything. You ain't got money, you ain't nothing, basically.
Basically, you know, we gotta do it. We gotta do it a different way. It's always a few ways to extend to this whole little money thing. It ain't always just about grinding or nothing like that.
We need more activities to get into. Maybe somebody could give us more opportunities that we could take, so we have to take less chances, you know?
Yes, there is a state of emergency in Oakland, and the root of the problem is poverty.
All right, you just checked out the shortened version of the real state of emergency. If you want to see the full-length version, check it out at youthoutlook.org or consciousyouthmediacrew.org. We're going to go on a break right now.
So it's been 10 years since that fatal day when we all learned that Tupac passed away. Where were you?
I was driving down the Excelsior when I heard the news.
Really?
Yeah, I heard it on the radio.
Yeah, me too.
It was whack because I thought he was going to make it. I really thought he was going to make it. Because he had gotten shot before, and this is the second time, and I was like, damn, dude, that's really bad.
Well,
where were you?
I was at home listening to the radio. I didn't even realize what they were talking about. They just were being all sad and stuff on the radio, and I was like, what is this about? Hi, can I request a song? And they're like, Tupac just died. And I was like, oh, my bad. I was like in eighth grade or something, though.
Yeah.
So I was a little bit young.
So then he really started coming out with albums after that, right?
All the
new albums started dropping, so. But right. Our reflections on that, this is young people reflecting on the death of an icon, really. I think it's hip-hop's greatest icon. You know, you can say whatever you want to say, but Tupac's probably the greatest icon in hip-hop. So let's check that out. He came from right here, this soil, where the rappers be getting their lingo from. also known as the Mighty Bay. So, I mean, this is people talking about it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Every Tupac song is a classic, but I remember there was one song that we listened to that was No More Pain with Devontae. No More Pain. And he did so many ad-libs, and it was just, you know, it was tripping us out because we was over there, you know, tripping off of what this guy was saying loaded.
My brother Andre, he's my oldest brother Dre, right? He loves Tupac, like, not even joking. That's how I, like, know a lot of Tupac songs or even have his CD because he has every CD that nigga made. Like, he got all of it. He got all the documentaries and the resurrections and all the other stuff he had or whatever.
My granny, she loved Tupac. Like, my granny was like in her 40s, 50s, and she still loves Tupac to this day. Like, you go in her room, you see like this picture, like she paid like $100 just so it can be, it's like this big and it's just right there and he's like sitting there, but it was like angel wings on them and stuff like that. But yeah, she used to always get like intoxicated and listen to the song. So we used to sing it like, the Dear Mama, yeah, and all the songs.
I adopted Tupac in 87.
Yeah.
I adopted.
Oh, yeah. Round
it goes. It was a big litter. And I said, I want that one.
Wow.
And I got him.
He was homeless good at the time, too.
Yeah, it was good.
So I put him up in my backyard. Like, somebody bought my German Shepherd, so I let him have a doghouse.
How you doing? It's Rick Edwards, Vice President of Machiavelli Branded. It's a classic black on white with a white Tupac Shakur image. Here we have a Money Prince shoe. And here we have, once again, just a classic red Machiavelli branded shoe, utilizing two different images, a front and a side hit. Dear Mama, because I love my moms. Baby!
You know why though? You know why I taught him to drink Hennessy and why Pop taught him to smoke? Because that's what they taught us. That's what Bob Marley taught us. That's what George Clinton taught us. That's what Miles Davis taught us. Right. And Billie Holiday taught me to do something I won't even do. I won't even do that. It's like before we know what's going on, we've already passed it down. We've already handed it down before we know what's going on. So, yo, we need some older prophets.
And now we got goers.
He was a great artist. I personally believe that he defined the generation at that time. A lot of people that were younger who didn't really understand Tupac, it was kind of like not the same for this and this generation. But Tupac at his time was the word of the streets. Everyone that he said believed him, and he just provoked so much thought in everybody that during the time Tupac was around, you know, it was like a really big thing because he knew what was going on in society that the average urban person would not know.
Tupac did have a hypeness about him, you feel me? Because hype isn't, it's a movement, you feel me? It's more than just you know, whatever you see now, people gigging and all that stuff. It's like a way of life. That's how people live. So I'm sure he was out here, you feel me? Like, he was in Oakland doing all, he knows all about the drugs that Oakland has gone through, the heroin, weed, X. So, I mean, that's just another little bump along the way.
Tupac and the beat. Wow. I guess we're moving. Yeah, we're 10 years. The Beat Within has been a publication of writing and art from inside various juvenile halls. And it started, the initial issue is on the death of Tupac Shakur.
Nah, Tupac is his own man. Tupac is just a straight poet. You know what I'm saying? He should have been a world speaker, you dig?
People need to stop saying, I want to be the next Tupac. People should just start saying, I want to be the first me. You know what I'm saying? And stop trying to emulate somebody who got killed for acting like an idiot. You know what I mean? Seriously, dude. He wore like bandanas all twisted around his head, all pretty. How long does it take every morning to tie your bandana so perfectly that the little bows come out like this? You know what I'm saying?
I like all Tupac songs. The new ones are just a bunch of old ones chopped up and put in one CD. So yeah, they all say the same thing, so.
He talks about like a lot of things. He was like young, but he been through so much since he was little, cause his mom was a black panther, and like he been through so much that I think like he talks about some real stuff that an average rapper wouldn't talk about.
What else can be said about the prophet Tupac Amaru Shakur? No. Come on, nothing else can be added to that. We know what it is. Y'all know what it is. Yeah, you don't need us to tell you what it is. Right. That was that.
All right, we are done here playing in Richmond. We're at the, I don't know even where we're at. We're near the harbor somewhere. There's boats over that way and little kids coming to play on this playground. Anyways, for more of our footage and good things like that, check us out at youthoutlook.org, right?
Yep.
What else?
Email us? You can also email us at yotv@youthoutlook.org. Send us comments, send us pictures, send us stories, story ideas, comics. Did I say comics already? No, I said comments.
Know.
Send us your comics. Send us anything and everything that you can produce. We want.
Mm-hmm. And if you want, you can even be here doing this kind of stuff. Making videos.
Yes.
Being on TV and all that good stuff.
Snapping your fingers. All right. So come through.
And we'll see you next time, YoTV.
You know, it's really funny how anybody could just write a song with this. If you just say, The Bay and Patron, then you have a song.
I'm in the Bay.
I'm with the Bay, Patron, the Bay, Patron, Patron, the Bay, Patron. All right, that's cool. That's a wrap. Got a hit. Cool. Make two remixes. That's it.
That's right. Shout out to Rexions and put it in a sing-songy tone.
Yes, I have to
do. It'll totally work.
Reggie Eagle, put peanut butter on your bread.